Good afternoon. The title of our presentation is Learning the Threshold Concept of Interlanguage in Blended Learning, a Phenomenographic Study. My name is Rosa Isela Sandoval Cruz, and the name of my co-author is Moises Perales Escudero. The goal of our study is to describe the experiences of a group of 16 Mexican pre-service EFL teachers while learning the concept of interlanguage in a blended learning environment using Moodle. The rationale. According to Winkle and West, 2019, online discussion forums are commonly used in blended learning. Nevertheless, pre-service EFL teachers' conceptions of learning disciplinary concepts through online discussion forums are under-researched. Now, a study has examined the learning of the threshold concept of interlanguage through online discussion forums in blended learning. The research question that guided this study was, how do participating pre-service EFL teachers experience learning the concept of interlanguage through Moodle online discussion forums? The theoretical framework, threshold concepts. According to Meyer et al., 2006, threshold concepts are disciplinary concepts that allow novices to understand phenomena in a new way. Not all disciplinary concepts can be considered threshold concepts. For a concept to be a threshold concept, it must have a set of characteristics. First of all, it has to be difficult, troublesome in the sense of destabilizing, transformational, discursive, and characterized by liminality, which is a long period of oscillation between progress and setbacks while learning the concept. Perales suggests that interlanguage is a threshold concept for language teachers, since learning it deeply involves abandoning traditional prescriptive views of error and error correction in favor of a scientific understanding of error as systematic, rule-based products of the learner's developing auto system, which is a complex linguistic system on its own. This involves identity shifts in teachers, from being the guardians of correctness to being more like descriptive applied linguists.
This is Moises Perales here, and I'm going to talk about phenomenography. Phenomenography is both theory and a methodological approach. Its focus is on experience, which is understood as awareness of something. Phenomenography posits that for any given phenomenon, there is a finite set of ways to experience it. Its goal is to describe carefully the range of varied ways of experiencing learning teaching phenomena. The way phenomenography researches experience is through conceptions. A conception is the verbalization of something one is aware of, that is, the minimal unit of experience and the unit of analysis in phenomenography. Conceptions are grouped into categories or distinct ways of experiencing. The things being experienced are called themes. The products of phenomenography are outcome spaces, or arrangements of categories and themes that capture all the ways of experiencing found in a sample of participants. Phenomenography distinguishes between two types of conceptions. There are conceptions of how learning happens or teaching happens, and that is known as the structural aspect of experience. And there are conceptions of what is learned or what is taught, and that is called the referential aspect of experience. The structural aspect is further subdivided into two parts. One part is conceptions about the nature and the actions of learning and teaching, that is, what is learning and how one learns, and what is teaching and how one teaches. And the other dimension is conceptions about the reasons behind learning or teaching in a certain way. And now the methods. The study was conducted at UCRO in a psycholinguistics class, and the participants were 16 English majors enrolled in this class. The class took place in blended learning with the assistance of Moodle and online discussion forums. We observed the unit focusing on interlanguage. We conducted three interviews per participant. We carried out an initial phenomenographic analysis with 12 of the interviews, which was used to develop codes The codes were applied to the remaining 36 interviews and modified along the way. And then we developed categories, themes, and outcome spaces. And now what I am presenting here is the structural outcome space. That is the how of learning, how they learn and what they think about that learning through the ODFs. So we find three broad categories going over the content, expanding knowledge metacognitively, and negotiating knowledge. And the first category basically involves thinking that responding to your peers, reading their messages, connecting with the face-to-face class, and connecting with the instructor are all connected to repetition and memorization. The second category has to do with thinking that all of these different themes work to assist metacognition, that is, to notice gaps in knowledge, to notice misunderstandings, and to repair them. And finally, negotiating knowledge is the most sophisticated category, and it involves thinking of writing your messages on Moodle and reading the messages of others as opportunities to critique other participants' ideas, to advance one's own ideas, and to promote debate. And the relationship with the instructor and the face-to-face class has to do with deciding who is right in a controversy among students. Here's an example of the first category. So as you can see, the student says, no solo saliendo de la clase como que dejamos ahí, sino que en nuestras casas tenemos que volver a repasar. This is an example of category two. Notice that the student talks about working in teams and how doing this kind of teamwork allowed them to get to know each other's opinions, compare information, and notice what was missing. Notice the things they did not know and how they could use what others had posted in order to fill in those gaps in knowledge. And here is an example of the most sophisticated category, which is negotiating knowledge. And from this category, students who are in this category think that learning is promoted by debating, by negotiating disagreements. And the student exemplifies that. She says that she felt she learned more because her team and other teams argued more. They had very strong disagreements, and they were able to settle those disagreements through the online discussion forums, and that produced the experience of having learned more. And now this is the referential outcome space. So the categories are no crossing, meaning those students who did not cross the threshold at all, who did not move forward in the path toward learning the concept of interlanguage deeply, and this was actually three students that were located in this category. Then there is the category of liminality, that is those students who oscillate between appearing to be learning the concept more deeply, and then they go back to their traditional old notions of error as something bad, as something that is a product of laziness, rather than a product of the interlanguage system. And finally, we have those students who crossed the threshold, who adopted a descriptivist scientific approach to error that views error not as a product of being lazy, not as a cognitive deficit, but rather as the result of the current state of the interlanguage system. And a defining feature of these students that crossed the threshold was the experience of reflection. These students who crossed the threshold were able to reflect critically on the traditional ideas about error and error correction and how they are detrimental to motivation. They were also able to reflect critically on how those prescriptive relationships between traditional teachers and their students are enmeshed, immersed in power imbalances and power struggles, and how that affects learning negatively. Here we have an example of the first category where the student insists that there is one correct way to speak. And she also says that the concept of interlanguage is a complicated concept. A common misunderstanding in this category was to think of interlanguage not as the linguistic system in a learner's cognition, but rather as a system that helps you learn, which is inaccurate. Here's another example of a learner that was scandalized because the teacher explained that in some native speaker varieties of English, the third person S, the S of the third person in the present simple, is not used. And she was quite shocked by that. And here's another example of category one, where a student expresses feeling stressed out by the concept of interlanguage, and because it involves several interrelated concepts and it's difficult to understand the connections among them, which is further evidence of the threshold nature of the concept of interlanguage. Here's an example of category two, where this learner actually understands what interlanguage is quite well, and she expresses it as a version of the L2 that they have in their heads, and that consists of rules and hypotheses which are influenced by the L1 in connection with the L2. Only three participants crossed the threshold, that is, they achieved a deep understanding of interlanguage and switched from a prescriptivist position towards a descriptivist one. And here is an example of that kind of participant, and as you can see, this person is able to reflect on the connection of interlanguage with other concepts that have to do with social linguistics and power, like the concept of a standard language. And she, it's very interesting that she says this, con la idea de lo correcto pienso que se va por el lado de target like, porque a veces nosotros pensamos que como nosotros hablamos es común, pero para otras personas puede ser que están mal. Pero eso no quiere decir que como ellos piensan que está mal, yo hablo mal. O sea, yo no hablo incorrectamente, sino que igual por lo que tenemos en nuestra cabeza. That is, she is aware that one's output is the product of rules in the system, rules in the mental system of interlanguage. And that's a good, sophisticated understanding of interlanguage, in that she assumes then that they are not wrong, that output, even if it contains mistakes or errors, is not wrong, but it's actually systematic, the systematic product of interlanguage. Finally, here is an example of another participant who crossed the threshold. He also shows awareness of the power imbalances involved in traditional prescriptivist positions when he says, te vas a ir con la persona que tenga más poder o más peso económico y social y vas a crear las reglas con respecto a cómo habla él. He's talking about, in the next sentences, el chico sabía muy bien, he's talking about a hypothetical exam situation where they had to grade a test that had some grammatical mistakes but showed very good understanding of the semantics of tense. And this participant was the only one in his team that was able to see that these non-target-like forms actually showed a lot of knowledge of English, even if the structures were not 100% target-like. The semantics and the understanding of the tenses was very good, and therefore this hypothetical student deserved points. And this shows a shift from a traditional prescriptivist view to a scientific interlanguage-based descriptivist one.
Conclusions. The participants experienced learning the threshold concept of interlanguage through online discussion forums in different ways, from less sophisticated ones, which included memorizing content, remaining stuck in traditional ideas, to very sophisticated ones, such as negotiating knowledge, transforming their understanding of error. Furthermore, the concept was difficult to learn. Only three participants crossed the threshold. Future studies should continue to investigate these and other threshold concepts in language teacher education. Conclusions. The participants experienced learning the threshold concept of interlanguage through online discussion forums in different ways, from less sophisticated ones, which included memorizing content, remaining stuck in traditional ideas, to very sophisticated ones, such as negotiating knowledge, transforming their understanding of error. Furthermore, the concept was difficult to learn. Only three participants crossed the threshold. Future studies should continue to investigate these and other threshold concepts in language teacher education.
Thanks for your attention. If you have any questions, feel free to ask.